All right, welcome everyone. For those that are not familiar, SIG stands for Special Interest Group. And these are groups that produce content that is delivered on top of CentOS Stream and CentOS Linux. And today, Davide will be telling us about the still fairly new Hyperscale SIG and what they've been working on.
All righty. Hello, everybody. My name is Davide. I'm a production engineer at Facebook. And this is an update on what we've been doing within the Hyperscale SIG. So the agenda for today, we'll start with a quick recap of what the SIG is about. We'll talk about deliverables and how you can use what we've been doing and what the recent work has been. I'll have a few words about the developer experience and some tools we've either used or we found useful throughout this. And we'll close with what's coming up in the pipe. So Hyperscale is a SIG that is primarily focused on CentOS Stream. Well, only focused on CentOS Stream, actually. The goal is to have a way to make it easy to manage and deploy CentOS on large-scale infrastructure. There's a lot of companies that deploy CentOS at scale, and they all tend to do kind of the same thing, and they all tend to do kind of the same thing internally within their walled gardens. And what we want to do here is to bring all of this internal development out in the open so that different players in the space, be them companies or individuals, can collaborate together and work together on the same tooling and bring out all of this development that tends to happen behind closed doors. It's open to everybody working in the space. You can find more details on the wiki page. And we have posted an update on SIG activities last month on the CentOS blog. So the SIG started in January with 6 founding members. We've gained 5 more members since then. Right now, it's primarily engineers from Facebook and Twitter. And some smaller companies. We are an IRC on Pound CentOS Hyperscale. You're welcome to hang out there if you want. We're mostly there during US time, as most of the folks here are in the US, but you're welcome to hang out there and ask questions if you'd like. We also have bi-weekly meetings on IRC. I'll have a link at the end where you can find details. And the meeting menus are published on the wiki. And finally, we're gonna start from this month doing monthly video hangouts / hackathons, where we'll just hang out over a VC bridge for an afternoon and work on things or chat. We've done a few of these as ad hoc sessions to work on specific problems, and we found them really useful. So we're going to try to do it in a more structured manner. All of the SIG activity is coordinated on Pegger, on our tracker. We try to make issues there for everything we work on, both to make it easy for people to understand what's going on and also to have status updates. And finally, we've tried to talk about this work in various venues. We have conferences, we have talks in various conferences where we went over either SIG work specifically or wider activities that Facebook or other companies are doing around CentOS that also impact SIG works. And I also have one upcoming talk at LISA in, I believe it's at the beginning of June, that will cover CentOS Stream and the work we're doing in the SIG. So what do we actually do? There's 4 main buckets, I would say, that we tend to put the activity that SIG is currently doing. The first one is faster moving package backports. So having packages available in the SIG that are more recent are tracking more quickly from what is currently available in CentOS. With the idea of trying to keep this as close as possible to what's available so that we can easily move changes and correlate bugs between CentOS and Fedora and other distributions. One example here is systemd, and I'll talk about it in a bit. Then we have packages that apply policy and configuration alternatives. These tend to be rebuilds of CentOS packages with something changed about it. So for example, IP tables with the legacy backend enabled. Or more recently, we pushed a rebuild of Utility Linux with a patch applied to enable a feature around setprev that is used for containers. Both these types are meant to be desktop-in replacements, so they should work on a stock CentOS Stream 8 system. And they shouldn't introduce any regression. The other section of packages is packages that are useful for testing at large scale, but that they may not be ready for prime time or they might have some ill side effects. And I'll have an examples of these later, and these are meant to go in a separate repo. And finally, we are starting to do work around developing a kernel that is faster moving and closer to upstream that is available within the SIG for use by CentOS. So let's talk about packages. Package backports are delivered to a package repos. You can get these repos now if you DNF install our release package, DNF install CentOS release Hyperscale. This will give you the main package repository After you do that, if you run a DNF update, it will replace a number of system packages with packages provided by the SIG. This should all be drop-in replacements, and we do test this. So if you do that now, your machine should still boot. Obviously, you should do your own tests and qualifications in your own infrastructure. But if you do find bugs, please let us know, because we want to fix them. Neil was kind enough to set up a tracker that you can use to file bugs on these packages. Because these are rebuilds, you probably shouldn't file bugs for these in Bugzilla, because those will go to the maintainer of the package for CentOS or for Fedora, and they probably won't know what you're talking about. So if you find bugs specific to Hyperscale, please file them there. So one example I mentioned before, something we're working on in this space, is systemd. For systemd, we have a backboard that tracks the latest upstream major release, which is currently 2.4.8 that we just pushed the other day. This is a drop-in replacement for the CentOS systemd with a few minor differences. Primarily, these are differences to keep it closer to upstream. The main thing is that this build defaults to the unified hierarchy with cgroup 2. So when you reboot your system, you will see that it comes up in cgroup 2 mode. You can still revert back to cgroup 1 if you want to, but the default is cgroup 2, and really what you should be using is cgroup 2. This also includes systemd UMD, although the default configuration isn't shipped yet, so you have to enable and configure this manually. It also requires PSI to work. PSI is the pressure information feature in the kernel. So if you're running the stock CentOS kernel, you'll need to pass PSI equal 1 on boot to enable this. With that enabled, UMD works very well. UMD, if you're not familiar, is a tool to manage out-of-memory situations in an automated fashion on a system. So it will detect when something is about to UM and kill it before the kernel UM killer comes in play. This is something we have deployed at Facebook, and it's also now the default in Fedora as of Fedora 34. Now, the stock systemd on CentOS ships with SE Linux support, and that was something we wanted to keep available in our backport. So we wrote a minimal SE Linux policy that keeps our backport working and functioning in enforcing mode. I don't personally use SE Linux that much, and I know barely nothing about SE Linux. So if anybody wants to test this and provide feedback on whether it's working correctly or if there's any bugs, especially with more side features of systemd, I'm fairly confident that the core stuff works fine. But if you're using one of the side daemons that systemd provides, so things like, I don't know, systemd journal or remote, those I'm less confident. So we would really welcome feedback on that. And then, of course, this is a newer systemd with all the features that a newer systemd would have. There's way too many to talk here. If you are interested in specific things, I would recommend to look through the news file that Upstream provides, because that has a lot of good information on what's available there. Now, how do we actually do this? We try to move the development of the systemd backport in the open as much as possible. This is a process that we used to have internally within Facebook, and we've managed to move out almost every piece of it. So the first part is that we have a repo that tracks the systemd GitHub repo that we use to stage patches. So if you go on that page repo, you will see that there's a main branch that tracks the systemd GitHub main, and it's updated daily. And then there's feature branches that are used to stage patches for the various releases. Then when release time comes, we have a set of scripts that we use to facilitate the release, and those are packaged in another repo called systemd relens. And finally, because systemd can change quite a bit, it can be a significant effort to build and update a new version. So going from 2.4.7 to 2.4.8, there can be a lot of changes. So one thing we had been doing at Facebook for a while was do daily builds of the systemd GitHub master against the current packaging to find out early if there were any issues or things we should change or discussions we should have with upstream. This same pipeline is now running on the CentOS CI. So every day in the morning, in the morning Pacific time, we have a job there that pulls the latest upstream Git master for systemd, builds a package on CVS, and if the build fails, we get notifications for that. And we've been doing this for a while now. And if you go on CVS, you look at the Hyperscale bot account, because this isn't a human, obviously, you can find the packages and download them. These aren't pushed to any repo because they only go through cursory testing. And I wouldn't recommend running these in production, but if you need to test a feature that's available in the systemd Git 3, you can use these packages, and they will hopefully make your life easier. By the way, if you haven't used the CentOS CI and you work in a SIG, you really should. The CentOS CI is awesome. It is essentially an OpenShift instance where you can run whatever you want to make your life easier as a SIG member. We found this really, really useful for systemd, and we plan to use it for other tools. One thing that we're also currently looking into is extending this to also do testing on live VMs. So one thing we would like to test is take this daily build, install it on a VM, boot it, or take a VM running the current version of systemd and make sure that the update works fine, the machine still boots fine, and run smoke tests on it. This is pending on the ability to use VMs in the CentOS CI, which is something that's being worked with the infra team. The other thing that I've been working on recently is a build of LLVM 12. So CentOS ships LLVM 11 as a module, as part of the LLVM toolset module. And they do plan to update to LLVM 12 for L8.5, but it's not there yet. And Facebook needed LLVM 12 for some internal work. So we figured we should do this work in the SIG in the first place. I spun up builds of LLVM Clang, LDB, and LLDB, so the whole stack, basically, and a rebuild of Mesa, because Mesa is built against LLVM. Now, these are non-modular builds, because we can't do modular builds in CBS yet. But they work fine, and there's no conflict. There's no conflict there. I haven't tagged these for release yet, because they need way more testing than what I've done so far. But they should be working, and if you happen to need a modern client, you can test them. And this has been a great example, I think, of collaboration between the SIG, CentOS, and Red Hat. Because this started with me filing a Bugzilla issue against LLVM, asking whether they were going to update it for 12. And they said, oh, yeah, we're going to do this for 8.5. And then I started working on this backport, and we hit some issues where in the initial version, we had a number of test failures that were really odd. So I pointed on the bug, and I mentioned, like, hey, we have these builds, and we've hit these test failures. And I mostly did that originally thinking, oh, if Red Hat is also working on this, maybe I can save them some time. And the maintainer came back with a link to an upstream change that they were working on that fixed the issue. And we were able to run builds with the upstream change applied, validate that we're fixing the problem, and go back and forth with LLVM upstream to help them validate a better version of that fix. This was a great example, I think, of the process working really, really well. And my plan then is once LLVM 12 becomes available as part of stream, to drop the SIG build, because at that point we'll be able to just use the official one. There's tons of other packages, and I won't read you through all the list, but I will point out a few highlights. We have a build of grep, which doesn't sound that exciting, except if you run any kind of infrastructure, you're going to have a lot of shell scripts that shell out to grep a lot. And grep 3.6 is a lot faster, like I think at least 20x faster than the version of grep that is in CentOS stream. So you might have a surprise performance improvement in your monitoring scripts. We also ship a very up-to-date version of less, because surprisingly, less is a dependency of systemd. And the new systemd happened to need a more recent less to, I don't know, like show emojis or something. So we just pulled it in. Neil just pushed yesterday a build of the Livert stack updated to 7.10. This is a non-modular build because, again, we can't do modular builds in CBS, but it works fine, and it doesn't conflict with the existing system one. Then we have a number of minor tools. We have build tools, MTR, which is a networking tool. We started to do some work on porting the Anaconda stack from Fedora initially because Facebook had a need to do builds of Fedora images on CentOS machines, and that requires a more recent kickstart. But what we'll probably end up doing is building Anaconda as well to enable ButterFS support there. And finally, another thing that worked recently was some TPM-related tools, both because we had a need of those internally, but also because the new systemd pulls in TPM2 TSS. Now, let's talk about the kernel. I know there's a lot of interest in having a kernel on CentOS with ButterFS support. So one thing we started working on this, specifically Justin from Twitter has been working on this for the most part, is having a more up-to-date kernel built within the SIG based on an LTS. So we do have a test kernel right now in CBS based on 5.10 with ButterFS support that works. It is in CBS. It's deliberately not tagged as a release because it needs it both needs testing and it has a number of outstanding issues that don't really make it suitable for wide use. Our plan is we also haven't quite figured out the development model for this yet. So our plan is to have a GitHub repo on Pager where we'll do development and coordination for this with likely with feature branches and release branches. The repo is there, but we haven't quite sprung up this process yet. And as I mentioned, there's a few outstanding issues with this kernel. One issue is that we don't really have a concept of KAVI here, because this isn't a RHEL kernel, and KAVI is effectively a RHEL kernel thing in this context. So if that's something that you care about, for example, if you're using modules from a repo and in other places, those obviously are going to need to be rebuilt. The main issue, however, is that we can't sign these builds when they're built in CVS, which means they're not usable if you're using EFI with secure boot. And that's an outstanding issue that we're trying to figure out what the best approach is. One workaround could be to use dedicated keys for the SIG, but that means that one will need to enroll them manually with mockutil, which isn't ideal. We are having a number of other conversations with infra to see if we can find a better solution here. Outside of the kernel on the user space side, one thing I ported recently was kpatch. If you're not familiar with kpatch is a tool that allows you to build on the fly, build a kernel module to apply a patch to your running kernel. So it can be useful, for example, if you need to apply a security update to a live kernel without rebooting it. Kpatch is shipped with CentOS, but the build part of it isn't shipped. So it's not terribly useful as is, unless you're using patches that somebody else made. So what we did was update it to the latest version and include the kpatch build, which is what lets you actually make patches. And this is something we're using, we're currently playing with at Facebook and testing, and we wanted to make it generally available in case it was useful for others. Now, the stuff I mentioned before are all things that we're targeting roughly the main repo, the one you get to do DNF install, CentOS release, Hyperscale. As I mentioned, we also have another repo for experimental changes. And the idea here is to have a place where we can land things that maybe aren't quite ready or that might have adverse effects to the system, but they're still useful to test in a production or production-like environment. The main example there and the main thing we have there right now is the RPM and DNF copy on write work that my colleague Matthew Almond is currently doing. This is work that is being shepherded as part of a proposal for Fedora 35 to leverage the features of copy on write provided by a file system like ButterFS to make package installs more efficient. As you might imagine, this requires patching the entirety of the packaging stack, so DNF and RPM and all that. So it's quite complex if you wanted to deploy this yourself. So that's why we provide packages that you can just DNF install. And these are the same packages that we're using in production at Facebook too. These are released, as I said, to their own experimental repo. So you can do DNF install, CentOS release, Hyperscale experimental to get this, and it will work just fine. And obviously, if you have feedback on this, that would be valuable both for CentOS and for Fedora, because we are trying to get this in for Fedora 35, and we're hoping it will be useful there as well. Now, shifting gears, I want to talk a bit about developer experience. If you are in a SIG or if you work in a SIG, there's a lot of operations you're doing around building packages and working with GitHub CentOS that are probably somewhat repetitive. So we went through a few of the things we were doing and tried to see whether there were improvements we could make. The first thing we did was build a project to hold configs for mock so that one can build packages against a SIG via mock. This makes it really easy to do local builds using mock, which is helpful for testing. So right now we have a repo there, and that only has Hyperscale configs right now because that's what we needed. But if any other SIGs want to put up PRs to add configs for their repos, we'd be happy to merge them. This is something that's packaged in Fedora and in Apple, so you can get it if you DNF install mock CentOS SIG configs. And then you will have configs like CentOS Stream Hyperscale, I think it's CentOS Stream Hyperscale, or CentOS Stream 8 Hyperscale, I don't remember, that you can build against. Something else that we recently got packaged in Fedora and Apple is CentOS Packager. CentOS Packager is the tool that provides you things like CentOS Cert and CDS, which is what you used to actually talk to CDS and the CentOS infra. This was available in a copper that Fabian maintained, but there was not really any reason why it needed to be in a copper. So we got it packaged in Apple to make it easier to consume. There's another project that I believe Carl started, which is SendPackage. SendPackage is an R package style tool. So if you use Fedora, you may be familiar with FedPackage, and SendPackage is meant to be the CentOS equivalent to streamline the development process. However, this only works for CentOS Stream 9 right now, because the repo format between Stream 8 and Stream 9 is different. Stream 9 uses Fedora style disk git repos, where everything is in the same folder. And Stream 8 and previous releases use the exploded SRPM style, where you have specs and SR and sources directories. My understanding is that it is technically possible to support the old style layout in SendPackage because it is supported by our package, but it will probably require a bunch of work. So I filed an issue this morning actually on this to track it, because I think it would be useful to have a unified tool for it. And hopefully it would make life a little bit easier for people. Other things worth noting, if you use Fedora for, if you use CentOS for any length of time, you are aware that there are some packages that you might expect to be there that are not there. And that is now fixed. And if you go on Mbox, you can download that. Well, not today, because Mbox is down, or at least was down this morning. But when it's back up, if you go there, you can download missing developed packages or any other packages that haven't been shipped to the distribution. This is really useful because it means we don't need to rebuild internally things like libuser anymore just because we need to develop package. It also opens the door to importing these packages on CVS so the SIGs can use them and consume them without having to rebuild stuff. And there's an infra issue to this end open. Something else around Git CentOS that I would really love to see and that I've talked about before is a working PR workflow. If you use Git CentOS today, you can technically open PRs, although you have to kind of jump through a few hoops. But once the PRs are open, there's no way to merge them. Because the way the repo is set up, nobody has merge access. And as a SIG, I would really like to be able to open PRs for my stuff or review PRs that other people make. But it doesn't seem to be an easy way to sort this out. So I suspect this will require either updating the version of Pegger that runs there or moving the whole infra to GitLab. But this is something that I think would be really, really useful. The other thing that this would open is if you use Fedora, on Fedora, when you open a PR, you get a scratch build created automatically. And that is invaluable for getting early signal when you're making changes. And that's something I think would be really, really useful to having CentOS Stream as well on Git CentOS. And again, there's a link to an issue tracking this work. Finally, another project that you may be familiar with is CentOS Git Common. CentOS Git Common is kind of a grab bag of scripts used to work to do CentOS work. There's two scripts that are fairly important in there. One is the one used to upload artifacts to the Lucas side, and the other to download them. If you don't know these exist, it's going to take you a while to find it. And it definitely took me a while to find it the first time. So we're looking at merging these scripts into CentOS Packager to make them more accessible. Because that hopefully will make life easier for people. Now, coming up, there's a lot of effort around ButterFS, as I mentioned. One thing we're hoping to do is to put together all these different work streams around ButterFS and integrate them into a unified experience. And that leads towards building a system that can do ButterFS transactional updates. If you happen to use, for example, MicroS from OpenSUSE has this. It's a way to batch updates by leveraging features of ButterFS like snapshots. This requires changes to the kernel. It requires a kernel that supports ButterFS. It doesn't require changes to the kernel. It requires an installer that supports ButterFS, and it requires user space enablement. So I think it's a really good test case to validate that we have good ButterFS support in CentOS. We obviously want to release a kernel package at some point. We will probably push it to experimental first, especially if it's not signed in the beginning. We'd like to figure out a way to build ISO images, especially, again, tied into the transactional updates work. It'd be really nice to ship full images that people can use with everything there. We would also like to work with the Cloud SIG on shipping cloud images with Hyperscale packages pre-installed already, especially systemd. And probably container images too. I should have put a bullet for there. Then, as I mentioned, the CentOS CI is awesome, and we're definitely going to use it for more things. I'm interested in adding more tests for that for systemd. I know Neil was interested in using it for Livert and other projects. I'm sure more cases will crop up where it will make sense to use it. And finally, if you use CentOS, you almost certainly also use Appel. There's currently a discussion on Devel and on the infra tracker on making Appel available in CDS. The idea is that if you're a SIG and you want to build something, either something that's against a package that's already in Appel, or if you need to consume a package from Appel, you shouldn't have to rebuild it in CDS and then potentially end up with duplicate packages conflicting it. You should be able to just reuse the existing one. For Hyperscale specifically, we will likely just make our release package depend on Appel release, because there isn't really any reason not to do that for us. But of course, other SIGs might have different policies. So hopefully this gave you a roundup of there. The thing I want to close with is Stream 9, because Stream 9 is here, if you haven't heard. Sources are there on GitLab. There's a Koji that is being used to build a distribution now. And you can download composes today. And they might even install in a VM if you boot them now. They did, at least the last one did for me. We would really like to start SIG builds on Stream 9 as soon as possible. I know that, speaking with my Facebook hat on, the moment we have signed nine composes available, because right now they're unsigned, we will start putting them in and testing them. And at the same time, we will want to test builds of everything else. So it would be really, really nice to be able to do Stream 9 builds in CBS as soon as possible. And to this end, there's already a few issues open on the tracker, one for Hyperscale and a few for other SIGs asking for tags there. So we'll see when we can start delivering things for 9 as well. I'm just going to close with a few links that you can use for reference. I'll email the slides to Rich later so you can download them and you don't need to write this down. But hopefully this was a useful roundup of what we've been doing, and I will be happy to take any questions you might have. Thank you. All right, let me see if we have any questions.
We don't have any questions yet. If anybody has questions, this is the time to speak up. The video and the slides will be linked from the wiki page shortly. We have a question. Oh, we don't have a question. We have a
comment. Oh, it was delivered 710, not 710. Thank you, Neil. Robbie asks, what is the best way for non-dev folks to assist with ButterFS additions? I would say once we have something that is actually testable, definitely testing it and providing feedback will be valuable. But by far, I think that is the main thing that I would say for everything that Hyperscale is doing would be useful, because there isn't that many of us, and we are all primarily testing these in our environments. It's extremely valuable to get feedback from someone trying to deploy these in different environments and figuring out what breaks, what works, what doesn't work very well, so we can fix it, because that makes life better for everybody. And we will make sure to communicate when we have something that's ready for testing. I'll definitely post on CentOS Devel some kind of announcement so people can know what to look for. Anything else?
Oh, again, not a question, comment.
Carl mentions that Brian, the service security for starting send packets, and several CPE people and RHEL maintainers have contributed to it as well. Thank you, Carl.
Well, thank you all for attending. Thank you, Davide, for this great presentation. And the video from all of the previous sessions is now on YouTube, and the video from this session will be up shortly. Thank you all so much for attending, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you. Bye.